At Direct Action Network, one of our core values is that we do our homework. We don't do things just because we like doing them. We do things because they serve the needs of the victims we represent. So 6 years into this experiment of trying to apply the lessons of history, the tools of social movements, the learnings of the greatest social scientists and activists in history, we have been far more successful as a movement within DXC and the animal rights movement than even I would have imagined. And let me show you how. In the past 6 years, over 150 cities in 30 different nations have taken action with Direct Action Network. We have garnered international media attention from the most important publications in the world. We have shown true grassroots power, leading to historic legislation like a ban on fur across the entire state of California, and major corporate shifts, including the closure of massive turkey farms. But these results are just a glimpse of what DXC and the animal rights movement is and what it can do, because at root, Direct Action Network is not about any particular action, not about any particular person or even set of persons. It is a platform, a formula, DNA for movement. And here is what that DNA says. This is how we've achieved what we achieved. Four simple steps to achieving animal liberation in other forms of social change in one generation. Vision, community, leadership, and nonviolence. And you should have a handout in front of you that shows you these four steps. We're also going to talk about the values that animate DXC. These are the values that infuse our mission, that infuse this theory of change, infuse every word we say, every step we take. We are fiercely nonviolent. We build purposeful communities. We do our homework. We lead by serving. We aim to do exceptional work for animals. So breaking down these four steps into three subsets, this is what we're going to go through today. This is our roadmap for the workshop. I'm going to be doing sections 1 and 4. My good buddy Nico is going to be doing section 2, and then Johnny over here is going to be doing the leadership section. Christina is going to lead us through exercises at the end of each module. So this is what we hope you all learn at the end of the day, and this is what we think and we have already seen can change the world in one generation. Sound good?
Good.
Cool. All right. So, but if we're going to learn how to change the world, as I said, it's so important to learn the lessons of history and understand some of the stories from history. And one of the most important stories is the story of this guy. This good-looking young gentleman. Any guesses as to who this gentleman might be? Any literature buffs in the room? Anyone studying literature in NYU? And hint, it's a playwright?
Oscar Wilde?
Close, but not quite.
Victor Hugo.
Victor Hugo, no? His name is also the name of a state of the United States of America. Streetcar Named Desire?
Tennessee Williams.
Okay. So Tennessee Williams is one of the most famous playwrights in American history. And like many people who are LGBTQ, he was, you know, someone who was in a marginalized class himself. In the 1960s and 70s, it was dangerous to be out and open, and he wasn't out and open. Instead, he flocked to the city of Key West in Florida, because it was one of the few places on the planet, frankly, that someone could be gay and live a reasonable, safe life. But even in Key West, which to this day is known as a mecca for the LGBT community, being gay was very, very dangerous. And in fact, in 1979, an ad was put out by a minister in the largest newspaper in Key West with the following words. This is an ad the main newspaper in Key West gladly and proudly published for the entire community. If I were the chief of police, I would get me 100 good men, give them each a baseball bat, and have them walk down to Wall Street and dare one of these freaks to stick his head over the sidewalk. That is the way it was done in Key West in the days I remember and love. Tennessee Williams was a very influential playwright at this time, one of the wealthiest and most influential men in America. But a few days after this ad was published, the minister's wish was actually fulfilled. Tennessee was dragged out of a club, beaten with a bat, and his glasses were smashed. Being the most prominent playwright in America was no protection. The people thought you were gay in 1979. But something happened just 4 years later with another prominent gay rights activist, just a few years after Tennessee was assaulted. A young Harvard law student by the name of Evan Wolfson, who's actually here in New York City, I've hung out with him quite a few times to talk about social change and animal rights, was writing a thesis for his degree at Harvard Law School. And his thesis made out a bold prediction, set out a very bold vision, that just 4 years after Tennessee Williams, despite being powerful and wealthy, was dragged in the street and beaten up just for being gay, he predicted that marriage equality, a world where the right to love someone of the same gender was enshrined as a constitutional right, would happen in one generation. In fact, he wrote a thesis about it and described marriage equality as a human right. He said that it needed to be integrated into the U.S. Constitution, either by an amendment or by a Supreme Court case. And Evan's vision, this vision of a world where everyone was respected no matter who they loved, wasn't just a courageous and radical vision by one young revolutionary lawyer. What Evan recognized in 1983, which we need to recognize today, is that bold vision wasn't just a dramatic prediction. It was a strategy for change. Because Evan, like every pioneering social justice activist in history, recognized that if we want to push people down a difficult path, we have to have a bold and beautiful vision to make it worth the sacrifice. So imagine you're facing a dangerous road like this, and say, I'm your buddy, and I'm saying, like, hey, look, there's this foggy road, there's all these danger signs, I'm hearing some howling, some people screaming down the road. Let's go down there. What are you gonna say to me? You say, why would I do that? That sounds completely absurd and ridiculous. This is a very scary road, you have no idea where you're going, there's no way in heck I'm going down that road with you, right? But what if I said, despite all the danger signs and the weird howling and screaming and fog, there was this on the other end? Right. Disneyland. So if you set out a big vision, and in fact, Disneyland and Disney World are places that people go, they spend 5, 10, 15 years of their life investing money, thinking and dreaming about their one opportunity to go to Disney World. And Disney World, for the record, is not the best place. The company treats animals awfully and human beings too. But the point is that when there's a beautiful vision that you can really see, you can feel, you can almost visualize yourself walking into that beautiful vision, it motivates people to create change. We have to do the same as social justice activists. We have to recognize that to get people to walk down the road with us, down this difficult journey, what often feels like a great sacrifice, we have to show them we're taking them to a transformative place, a place that is more beautiful than their greatest dreams. And what is that vision? Well, this is our vision. This is baby Lily, who we rescued from a massive Smithfield pig farm. When we found Lily, her leg was seriously injured. She had a foot that was swollen up the size of a golf ball. She was shriveled up, malnourished, about 2 pounds, when all the other piglets were 13 pounds. So imagine a fully grown adult human who was 30 pounds. That was approximately how malnourished she was when we found her. Her mom was trapped in a metal crate called a farrowing crate that was so small and confined that her mom, despite the fact that her baby was starving to death, could not even turn around and look at her little baby face to face. But Lily is now safe because we had a vision, a world where babies like Lily are treated with decency and respect and kindness. So we walked right into that factory farm. We took her out, and she is living today on a beautiful sanctuary with a yard, a family, and friends, because that vision was something we were willing to fight for. And that is our vision, not just for Lily, but for all the animals of this earth. We envision a world where all the slaughterhouses are gone, where all the huddling, crying babies like Lily are given compassion and not killed, and where the right of every animal on this earth to live free from violence is enshrined as a constitutional right. We want animal liberation enshrined in the very fabric of our nation, into the DNA of our society. We want this, and we should say this. We cannot be afraid to ask what we really want, because it is what the animals need and what our base is willing to fight for. This is our vision. This is what we will rally behind, and this is what we will achieve. This is what's going to motivate a movement. So you fired up a little about that vision?
Woo!
You excited about the world where all the animals are free? Well, here's the second point about the vision. The vision isn't just a motivational force in the movement, whether it's the gay rights movement or the animal rights movement. It is a roadmap for us to clearly see how we get there. Does anyone remember the days before Google Maps? Some of you probably in this room remember.
Oh, yeah, of course, paper
opening up a map.
Nowadays, when you want to get somewhere, you just pull out your phone, right?
Nice.
You click where you're going, and it takes you to the video.
I don't have to ask anymore.
Yeah. So, Joey is a longtime supporter of ours, who I haven't seen in a while. So just, I have to take a moment and say hi to him and say, you know, it's really good to see you here, buddy. But in the days before Google Maps, what did you do if you wanted to get from New York City to San Francisco?
Take a paper map.
Take a paper map. But what do you do? What's the first thing you do?
You navigate it, yeah.
You navigate it, but what do you do with the map? So you say, like, I need to get to San Francisco. This is where I want to go. I dream to go to San Francisco. Yeah. So you find out, you start where you're going to go, right? Mm-hmm. You don't start with your first step. You don't say, like, okay, I'm going to get to San Francisco. Well, I'm going to turn left at 11th Avenue. It's like, well, no. I mean, how do you know you're supposed to turn left?
Right.
If you haven't looked at your destination, right? And this is not just an anecdote. When you look at the best research into complex strategic scenarios, whether it's military strategy, political strategy, business strategy, you always start with the outcome and you walk back. So if we don't have a clear vision, if we don't have a concrete world we're trying to create that you can actually just almost physically feel, it's very hard for us to ascertain what next steps we have to take. So when it turns out, when you look at the research and evidence on strategy, the more distant and complex that outcome is, the more important it is for you to set that target very clearly and very firmly in your crosshairs so you can know that every step you're taking is the right step. So we're going to do a little exercise now. And actually, Christina, you want to introduce people to this exercise?
Yeah.
To show how important the vision is to helping you understand where we need to go.
So we're going to practice these three steps that help you develop a vision. So step one is to identify a problem. Step two, envision the solution. And then step three, to brainstorm a first step you can take right now. Right here is an example. First step, to identify a problem. Animal cruelty laws are rarely enforced. Step two, what's the solution? Well, a possible solution is an animal rights division of the Department of Justice. And then the third step, to take a first step. Find a politician right now who supports animal rights.
And let me just add something about that second step. When we envision the solution, dream big. Don't let the world around you limit you. Just say, in my world of worlds, in my utopia, what can we do to make this problem no longer a problem? Because that's important, to have that clear vision of where you can go so you can see what steps you need to take today to get there.
So here we have the prompts again. We're going to take 6 minutes, and I'm going to set a timer. And you all can, you know, take notes if you want, write something down, think about it. And then we're all going to come back together, and a few folks can share what vision they have. Here are a few possible areas you can think about, what kinds of problems you want to identify, and try to propose a first step for. All right.
Yeah, so I'll just give you, in the primary school system, our kids are taught a food pyramid that says they need to eat meat and dairy. That's a huge problem, right? So, and we've probably experienced this. Maybe some of your kids are experiencing this. Envision a solution to that problem, and then think of one step you could take right now, literally right now. Phone call and email, some research you can do right now. Similarly with our grocery stores, right? We have butcher shops that are marketing products as humane, sustainable, and healthy, despite the fact that we all in this room probably know, we all in this room know that that's far from the truth, right? So how can we solve that problem? What does our perfect world look like in grocery stores? And what step, one step you can take right now to fix that problem? So everyone understand? Any clarifying questions before we do this exercise? And we hope you get out of this. Actually, I won't say what we hope you get out of this, because let's see what we get out of it, and we'll talk in a minute about what you got out of it, okay? So go at it. So imagine one of these areas, and take these three steps. We'll reconvene in about 6 minutes and give you all an opportunity to share.
So individually or as a group?
Individually.
And we pick our own.
So this
problem.
Is an individual. You can pick your own problem. This is a list of possible areas where you can think about a problem that relates to animal rights, climate change, or frankly, even some other costs. And we're going to go through this together to give you a chance to experience what this visioning exercise can do for you and making you feel like you can take action.
I can't envision a solution. Sometimes I try to approach someone, a stranger on the street, and talk to them. Sometimes they go, oh, no, this is fake. I said, but they mix, you know, and sometimes they are sold as fake. And they say, no, I make sure that blah, 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 blah. I said, well, I'm just, you know, sharing with you my concern. And sometimes people go, I don't care. You know, that's the answer. I don't care if it's an animal. And then I, speechless, I don't know what else to do. I don't know the next step beyond that.
Yeah, so maybe the solution could be finding a better way to outreach to folks so they can take in information, which this workshop will, you know, kind of goes over that. And then finding a first step after that is a way that you can kind of figure out what you need to do today to solve the problem.
So think
says,
big. So
I don't
here's,
care.
Here's one solution.
Say, right?
One solution might be let's just ban it in the entire city. And then we don't have to worry about whether it's fake or not because we know it's illegal. It's not fake, right?
Yes.
And one step we could take, well, you could come to this workshop and learn about how we ban fur in California.
Yes.
Right?
So. It started small.
Start small. Yeah.
Thanks for sharing. And you wanted to share what's your name?
Lydia. So the problem is a religion, religious justification, where people say God put animals for us to use. And then the solution that I envision that all religions state clearly that animals are here with us, not for us, and that dominion means more like a stewardship, where it's our responsibility to actually protect and care for animals rather than use them. Now, the first step would be hosting, educating people about true meaning of religious verses that relate to our relationships with animals, and also to show that what's happening today to animals simply cannot be approved by benevolent God.
Yeah, that's great. And one more share. You want to share?
Sure. This is something that actually happened. It's not animal, but it's a landfill, Fresh Kills in Staten Island, which was the largest in the world. Garbage landfill.
Landfill?
Mm-hmm. Which of course affects all life. The objective was to shut it.
Shut it down.
Yeah. So we were able to get a pro bono attorney who sued.
Nice.
And a lot of public speaking. We got over 200 groups signed on. We got a judge, took him out to the landfill, 92-year-old, ruled to shut it down. That was his last official act. Then he died. This was in the mid-90s. And we started out not really understanding what we were going up against, the waste management cartel. We succeeded just from tenacity and focus, and we also got free billboard space because our children were all sick in Staten Island.
That's great.
Cancers and stuff.
Yeah, thanks for sharing.
So it was just seeing the goal, which was to shut it down and stop the illness.
Yeah, so this is exactly what we've been doing at DXE for the past 6 years, basically taking our best ideas and putting them together and creating the 40-year roadmap to animal liberation. And you know that's really valuable because then you know not only where you want to go, where you want to be, but also what you need to do today to get started so you can actually get there.
And hopefully that exercise, I mean, we spent 5 minutes doing this, but when effective organizations and communities and groups do strategic planning, they might spend 5 months engaged in a process like this where they build that collective vision, put in their crosshairs, this is where we're going, and then walk step by step as if you're looking at a map from San Francisco to New York and find road by road what road you have to take and what path you have to take to go from New York City all the way to San Francisco. And that's what we've done, as Christina said at DXC, and here's the roadmap we've constructed from that exercise over the past 5 or so years. By 2025, we want animal rights hubs to begin developing across the world, in places like Bay Area, Berlin, maybe New York City, unapologetically demanding a constitutional bill of animal rights. Daring open rescues and powerful protests are generating attention across the world. Community building efforts are harnessing that attention, causing other supporters to rally to these key cities in a self-reinforcing cycle of change. It's the beginning of a real social and political movement. By 2030, animal rights has become the norm within these key C cities. And eating animals is becoming culturally stigmatized, a little like smoking cigarettes is today. Progressive organizations are feeling pressure to take a stand on animal rights, and after 10 years of local efforts to push laws supporting the right to rescue, finally, a former president of the United States, Barack Obama, says that he supports rescuing animals from factory farms. By 2040, major protests and disruptions are happening across the country, and they dominate the news cycle. We passed a statewide referendum in California to protect all animals from violence. This starts a contentious national debate as people across the world begin to wonder, is killing animals for food and for other reasons going to soon become history? In 2050, after 500,000 people march on Washington, species equality will go before the Supreme Court. We are near the point, the critical point, where 3.5% of the US population is mobilizing and hitting the streets for animal rights. A majority of the public now enthusiastically supports rescuing animals from harm. And the remaining animal industries can see that the writing is on the wall. And finally, in 2060, we have won. A national constitutional amendment enshrines the right of every sentient being on this earth to be free from violence. A, quote, Marshall Plan for Animals is passed in the United States, devoting 2% of our nation's gross domestic product to caring for the remaining animals rescued from slaughter and from industry. Animals are now seen as who they are, not what they are, but who they are, as legal persons, not property. Sanctuaries have replaced all the slaughterhouses on the planet Earth, and we have changed the world. It's a beautiful vision, right?
Oh, yes.
A vision that can inspire us to fight and guide us down the long path we need to take to get there. But there's one other thing that becomes readily apparent when we start envisioning the world we want to achieve and going through that roadmap of how we can get from where we are today to where we need to be. And it reflects the mistake that I made as an animal rights activist 15, 20 years ago when I just got started at the University of Chicago on the south side of Chicago. 15 years ago actually, when I was an animal rights activist, this is what I did. I spent 95% of my time handing out leaflets on the street, trying to convince people to go vegan. And what's the problem with this approach that I took? Spending 95% of my time focusing on trying to get people one by one to go vegan. Once we've seen
there's
the bigger systemic
time.
Vision, there's not enough time.
Yeah.
And there's so much more that we need to change, right?
Yeah.
We need to change our laws. We need to change our schools. We need to change our economic systems, the subsidies. We need to change so much. And what that tells us is when we start looking at what we actually need to change and walking through step by step how we can actually get there, we recognize the problem in the world isn't just like one person or even a collection of people whose minds we need to change. It is that there is a broader system that is the heart of the problem. It is the entire system, a system that is often very much rigged against ordinary people, rigged against the compassionate kid who doesn't want to eat meat, rigged against the veterinarian who doesn't want to experiment on animals, rigged against the doctor who doesn't want to believe the pseudoscience they're being taught that people have to eat meat to get the protein. It is this system that we need to change. And we can understand that clearly once we have a roadmap, right? So too often we as animal rights activists think that, oh my gosh, like the people around me are not vegan, I need to try to make them vegan, and that's what we've been taught for most of the past 20 years. That our goal as animal rights activists is just to one by one convince these people to go vegan. But in fact, when you look at the best social justice activists, when you look at the most distinguished and renowned social scientific scholars who've understood and work their entire lives to understand how social change happens, you start realizing that you don't change individuals, you change the system if you actually want to create real change. This is part of what makes DXC dramatically different from most of the other animal rights groups out there. We focus on the system, not on blaming individuals, but on changing the system that is corrupt, that is greedy, that is exploitative, and that hurts human and non-human animals alike. And the people out there on the street, even the people eating animals today, they are not our adversaries, they are our future allies. Let's break it down again. Our vision, far from being a weakness, a lot of people will say that if you dream too big, if you're too radical, if you're too utopian, no one's gonna trust you, no one's gonna believe what you have to say. Far from it. Our vision is not a weakness, it is a strength. because it inspires us to act. It gives us a roadmap so that even our biggest dreams can suddenly seem realistic. And finally, it helps us understand the systemic nature of the problem.
A great nation is judged by how it treats the most vulnerable amongst us.
I was there when Russell Simmons called Bernie to offer a possible endorsement. He talked about really stopping animal production. Bernie said, no, I think that, you know, Americans like to eat beef, they like to eat pork, they like bacon. Bernie said, no, I'm really for the farmers.
No, not right now, you can't. Please, thank you.
Animal liberation now!
Come on, you guys are